Hello everyone, it's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. How are you? This is the first time we've done a webinar in this format. Is the sound coming through okay? Can everybody see and hear me? Right, I just remember there's a delay. So if folks can see and hear me okay, can you just send me something that says that you can see and hear me? That would be great. That would be wonderful. I want you to start getting questions to me as well. You can start getting questions to me by typing into your chat box, and that would be really great, and I will get to as many questions as possible. Yep, it sounds like everybody can hear me and see me. I just remember that there is a delay. It looks like we're at about a 30-second delay. Once this gets going, it won't make a difference at all, because what I'll be doing is I'll be going through all of the different the questions. So if folks have questions, you can start sending them to me. That'd be great. Great, thank you so much. A lot of people in the room tonight, which is great. This is the first of many. We've also started doing our video podcasts on the radio show. Every Saturday, you'll actually be able to see into the radio station what is actually going on during the show, as well as behind the scenes. So that's going to be really exciting. It'll be interesting how this one goes tonight, and this is sort of like a trial. I appreciate everybody participating in this, and I see a lot of familiar names, and I really, really appreciate all the support on this. That's wonderful. So let's start getting some questions going. That'd be really, really great. A couple of things that we can start talking about, though, is a lot of people have been asking me about what is calm on command. So Erica, I'm going to get to your question. I'll tell you what, let me go right to the questions, and if I run out of questions, then I'll start talking about other things. So Erica writes, I have a lab. She licks us constantly. Okay, Erica. Number one, I would have her checked by a vet. So let's check her levels. Maybe she has a sodium deficiency. But it also could just be pushy behavior. So what I would do is, Erica, is start creating space. Okay? So if you have not seen any of my videos before and seen what the place command does or downstay is, space is incredible. So if you think about it, Erica, putting your dog in a down or place 2 feet, 5 feet, 8 feet away from you, getting your dog to be nice and calm and relaxed while you're sitting on the couch, when you're at your computer, when you're reading a book, how theoretically can your dog lick you? So it's probably a pattern behavior. If the dog's always been doing it and you've been frustrated, it's possible that by you not stopping it, you are training it. So what's that? Well, that's a really good point. Just remember, what you don't stop, you train. So all dogs are trained. We either train them to do what we want, or we train them to do what we don't want. Always keep that in mind. Megan, my dog wasn't socialized for the first 1.5 years. He will growl and snap at strangers. He only likes my husband and I. What to do? Okay. So I'm going to sort of help you on this one, Megan, and I'm sort of going to do avoidance training. Let's not have anybody meet the dog for now. Let's not have anybody meet the dog for now. That's going to be the safest thing. Now, you can start by making sure your dog is properly obedience trained. And I want your dog to learn how to be calm around people. What's your dog's state of mind when your dog is around people? Is your dog all agitated? Is your dog want to jump on them to say hello? When you come home, is your dog jumping on you to say hi? That's the same type of energy that it is that they go towards someone. Let's do this, though. For a while, let's do avoidance, meaning get your dog to politely sit, lay next to you while there's people around. Get your dog to stop worrying about people. So what's happening is it's standard. This goes across the board for a lot of things. People assume that the act of smiling, talking in a high-pitched voice, "Hi, puppy," reaching out, is friendly. It's actually an act of aggression. Some dogs, you can do that all day, they'll never aggress towards you. Other dogs freak out. So what I want you to do, Megan, is keep your dog next to you on a loose leash. Don't let your dog be pulling. Meet lots of people, but don't let the people pet your dog. So you're going to come across sort of as like an ass, which is fine. I have no problem being the rude guy on the street with a well-behaved and trained dog than someone that feels like they have to accommodate everybody. Just remember, if your dog nips or bites someone, it could be putting your dog down. Putting your dog down. All right? So let's see. These questions are coming in really fast here. Beth, very curious about working with a fearful dog such as the recent one you have been training. You have to be more specific. Most of the dogs that we have are fearful. I just lost your question. Coming in really quick here. I have a rescue collie who is very similar. Is it okay to use a prong on a nervous, fearful dog? Can you explain more about the structured walk you are doing with your fearful walk? So far, we have only walked this dog around the block, but he's miserable, nervous, hypervigilant. Okay, Beth, you're probably talking about a dog named Bo who came up to us from New York. You get a lot of New York City dogs. The dog is terrified. And if you watch the video, you can tell that the dog is terrified. Every sound the dog wants to trigger on. Now, yes, use a prong collar on a fearful dog. Yes, use a remote collar on a fearful dog. The best thing you can do, Beth, for a fearful dog is an incredible amount of structure. I want you to choreograph that dog's day from wake up to go to bed. Absolutely crate that dog. If your dog struggles in the crate, what I want you to do is I want you to watch my video on separation anxiety. Follow everything. The video on separation anxiety, 13 ways to prevent and eliminate it, is actually a great video across the board. If folks haven't seen it, at some point I'm going to be able to queue a lot of these videos up. I can't do that right now because I'm just trying to experiment with these webinars. So if your dog is in the proper heel position, walking at you, no sniffing, no marking, no lunging, no biting, no aggressing, no pulling, no lagging behind, your dog then is going to work through these issues, work through these issues. So yes, fearful dog, do duration work, long places, long downs, perfect walks, get the dog to be acclimated to the crate. That's really, really important. Pierre, hey Pierre, we've been training down here in Paraguay. Do you have tips on motivating a lazy, lazy, lazy dog? Client has a bulldog that is heavily overweight. We've tried prong, slip lead, his toys, his normal harness. We've tried picking him up to show him what we want him to stand up and push him to start. Okay, he's a very low energy dog. All right, Pierre, this is what we're going to do. I want you to stop feeding the dog. I want that dog to work for its food. So you've got a really overweight dog that's lazy. It's a bulldog. This is what I want you to do. Make sure it's eating kibble. Don't feed the dog. For a full day, don't feed the dog. It's not going to die. It's not going to starve. Now, if it has a medical issue, that's a different story. I'm going to assume it doesn't have a medical issue, but if it does not, don't feed the dog. Start training it with food, believe it or not. So unmotivating dog, let's use its hunger drive. Hunger drive, meaning, guess what? It will get hungry. It will start doing stuff. If you want to eat, you got to walk. If I want you to sit, to lie down, to go to place, to recall to me, to get onto a treadmill, you have to walk because that's how you get fed. So structured walks, food. Recall, food. Treadmill, food. A really overweight bulldog, talk to the vet first, make sure the dog's heart is okay, but chances are it can do it. All right, so you're going to do that. You're going to do that, Pierre. Let me just go through these questions here. Thank you so much for everyone. Pierre, it's great to hear you down in Paraguay. Let me get through these, how these are coming in. It's an interesting concept here, how they're coming in. Megan, you're welcome. Megan, just keep in mind, 50% of the dogs that we deal with in our board and train are fearful, all right? The worst thing to do for a fearful dog is coddle it. It doesn't make sense. Your natural inkling is to be, oh, poor baby, I'm sorry. Don't do it. Fearful dogs, remove this. Only think of this. It's going to be hard. It's going to be really hard. Remember, the reason why we get the results that we get is because we do the hard stuff. If we only did the easy stuff, every dog would be trained. Alyssa, A quick one, Linda. What do you think about muzzling to eliminate the biting fear? Excuse me, my nose is itching me here. And the owner can also calm down. Linda, absolutely work a muzzle. Any dog with a bite history should be muzzle conditioned and have the muzzle on. We like Jafco, J-A-F-C-O, Jafco muzzles. You can also use, what's the name of those muzzles? Baskerville. Baskerville muzzles, though, be careful. If a dog goes at you with clothes on, it actually can grab your clothes through it and destroy your clothing. I mean, once they get a hold of you, it can pull you in. So what I want you to do is get a Jafco muzzle, get it fit to it, counter-condition it with a Jafco muzzle, and start working it. Gail, like the video you posted today of the fearful dog on the walk. My dog is the same. How many times per day should I do the structured walk to work on this? Do four short walks, Gail. Do four short walks. Best thing to do is do four short walks, highly structured. It's the best thing you can do. Kathleen, we're going to be moving, and our dogs will have to be crated and flown. They've never been crated. You'll also have to go through customs. Any suggestions? Yes. Let the crates that you're going to do, the airline crates now that you're going to be flying them in, keep them in all night and multiple times a day. Make sure those dogs are crate trained all night, multiple times a day. I've had plenty of dogs come to me through the air. We get a lot of dogs flown into us to the Boston airport. It works. It's fine. One thing is, if you're flying into a hot city, be really careful. Be really careful. If the layover is in a hot city, be careful. I'm going to suggest you go with a direct flight. If it costs more, do it. If you can afford to charter a private plane or get them on a small plane, that would be really great. Thank you, Kathleen. I'm going to try to get to everybody. We've got a lot of questions. Thank everybody for doing this. This is the first time we've been doing it. It's really great. Linda, I answered your question. Alyssa. My English Springer Spaniel is 12 and a half years old. Congratulations. And just started getting separation anxiety. I had a complaint by my neighbor that he was barking a lot. I started to put him in my bedroom with a treat. He urinates a couple of times before I get home at lunchtime to walk him. He gets anxious before I leave for work and starts panting and whining a little. At this age, how do I stop him from getting anxiety? The vet did give me medication, but I really don't want to do that. I'm holding off. How can I retrain him when I just close the doors? Okay. Separation anxiety. Watch my video on separation anxiety, 13 ways to fix it and prevent it. It's going to involve a crate. Barking, it's going to be a bark collar. I don't care what anybody says. Obviously, I'm very opinionated. I don't think my way is the only way, even though it appears that way 95% of the time, and according to Linda, 100% of the time. But your dog's home alone. You are away. How do you stop your dog from barking? Anyone? Anyone? Give it Kongs. Fine, give it Kongs. Give it 20 Kongs. Play music. Fine, play music. What a remote collar. So a remote collar is going to be a stim. You're not zapping. You're not shocking. The dog's not going to fly through the air. The bark collar that I want you to use, get the Garmin bark collar. It's made by Garmin. Garmin. It used to be Tritronics. Garmin bought it. So you get the Garmin bark collar. Do it at home. Start on the lowest setting. Leave the house. Listen. If the dog barks and goes, oh, it works. If the dog barks and barks and barks and barks, then enough. Turn it up. So that's what I want you to do. But I also want you to watch that video on separation anxiety. Pierre, you're welcome. Nina, can anyone else see the chat log? I've got it on private now, just because I don't know what's going to be coming through, all the different questions. All right? Linda, thanks. I use them now and I totally agree. Awesome, Linda. Kate, I have a question you may have never been asked before. Okay. I have a 7-dog dog sled team. What? As a team hooked to the sled, they become reactive towards loose or leash dogs. This behavior doesn't exist with 1, 2, or 3, only when we all get hooked up together. No redirection towards each other, that's really great to people. I have tried both stopping the team and driving them forward at the same speed and at a faster speed with a mindset that the moving dog is a working dog. Any suggestions? Okay, you're right. I've never been asked a dog sled question. I assumed all you guys had like dog sled gurus out there. Isn't there like a dog sled whisperer out there? Okay, Kate. Just remember, when your dogs are about to race, you want them in an adrenalized, you want them literally chomping at the bit. They're chomping at the bit, and then boom. Hopefully, when they start pulling, feeling pressure and pulling, they are in 100% work mode, and they are not focused on anything else. Is this when you're hooking them up? If you're just hooking them up, what you're going to have to do is you actually can keep them calm. I know this sounds counterproductive. Same with a lot of fly ball and agility dogs. You can actually keep them calm until it's ready to go. How do you do that? One dog at a time. One dog. Hook up another one. Both of you are calm. Hook up the third. All you are calm. Fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh. Now, I don't know if that's counterproductive to racing or to competing, but I know that you can turn a dog off and you can turn a dog on. And you can have the highest drive dogs out there, and you know what? Those dogs can still perform at maximum capacity going from calm to get going, whatever your command is for get going. I would try that. But also, is there anybody else out there that can keep these other dogs away? So do you have an assistant that can keep all those other off-leash dogs away to help you as well? Get a dressage whip. You've seen them in our videos before. Keep the other dogs away. Advocate for your team. So maybe the team doesn't feel like you're advocating for it. I don't know. But that's what I would start doing. Try that and see how it works. Maybe don't try it with a full team. Maybe try it with five of the dogs. Bill, I have not seen any comprehensive teaching materials. I have not seen any. Do you recommend any instructional DVDs or books for training? If you go to the Learburg site, www.learburg.com, Learburg has got great information. You won't agree with it at all. You know, nobody agrees with, you know, all of anything. So what I want you to do is I want you to go to the Learburg site if you want, check everything out, see what's going on over there, see what you like. There's also a bunch of streaming videos you can do, so you can get streaming videos. Sean O'Shea's blog posting is incredible. In my opinion, no matter how you train your dog, Sean O'Shea from The Good Dog, you go to his blog, and it might be The Good Dog Way, or just go to his website, thegooddog.net, read his blog. No matter how you train your dog, the information there is really, really key. Barb, Denali has started to humping me again. He has stopped and just started again last week. Don't let him do it. Don't let him do it. If he's on the remote collar, high-level correction. You'll very rarely ever hear me talk about a high-level correction. If Denali is a chronic humper, something's going on. It might have to do with the fireworks, though. Is it happening at night, or is it happening at during the day more? This time of year, dogs are going nuts. I've got one personal dog, my oldest dog. We have to lock him up in a bomb-proof crate. The other day, he actually broke through a basement window when he got stuck behind a I talked about this on the radio show. He got stuck behind the heating unit. We didn't even know until the next morning. Hannah, I have a medium prong on my dog. However, she works through every single correction, is becoming even more reactive. Should I use a different technique from you and Sean O'Shea? Hannah, it's all about the timing. I'm not sure what you're doing. If you can send me a quick video, that would be really, really great. Hold on, I'm hearing some interesting noise coming from my house. There we go. It's all set. Just making sure here. I lost my thing of thought. Don't ever let me do that again. That was really rude. I'm really sorry, guys. It's easier to be Hannah to be proactive. So make sure you're proactive with it. If you're always finding yourself reacting instead of being proactive. If you're trying 180s. If you're trying to spin around. If you're trying heading the other way. If you're trying getting some more space in between your dogs. Send me a video. I need to see a video on that to see. You might think you're doing it properly. I might see it a little bit different. All right. Thank you so much. Tara, what's the definition of a short walk? A couple of blocks? All depends. So you got a grossly overweight dog, one block might be too much. You know, to me, a short walk in this weather, midday is 15 minutes. When it's below 70, half an hour is a short walk, in my opinion. You know, a short walk, if the average person walks 3 miles an hour, half an hour is only 1.5 miles. That's not very long for a walk. But if you've got a dog that's really, really overweight, that dog's going to struggle. All right? Hannah, I got to you. Oops. Thank you guys so much for doing this. Um, Joe, first time I've met him. How about his dog training philosophy? Joe, shoot. I don't know who you're talking about, Joe. Hold on. Joe, shoot. Joe, I don't know who you're talking about. Are you meant to be talking about Sean? Because he's awesome. I don't know who you're talking about. Joe, just tell right who you're talking about. Sam, hey, Sam, what's going on? You had said that on that, let's see. Okay, out command. Sam wants to know, you must listen to me on my radio show. Thank you so much. I changed the way that I did do the out command. So what I'm doing is, on the out command, I used to just do out, and it was okay for me for the dog just to back away from the resource, food, toy, ball. Now, especially around food and any high-level resource with my out, it was a great photo that I put up on my Facebook page. One of them was with Sean, another one was with me. I want the dog not to be, so if, here's my cup of coffee, so to me, so if I'm drinking my coffee, out, that's not out. This is out. Out, I don't care about the cup of coffee. That's what I want, Sam. So I don't want that dog to think about the food. I don't want that dog to think about the resource. All right? I gotta start deleting some of these as they come in. Hold on here. If I'm not getting everybody in order, I'm sorry. These are coming in out of control. Ryan, I'd like to know more about your pack walks, the goals, expectation, rules. All right. So pack walks are interesting. You don't have to do a pack walk to be successful. The thing about a pack walk is this: it empowers the human a lot as well. So how many humans are out there that can't even walk one dog? Think about this. You're able to walk a pack of dogs. A pack of dogs. It's pretty powerful stuff. From a dog's perspective, the benefit we have from a pack walk is this. We can take dogs that don't like each other, but they have to learn to exist with each other. Pretty incredible stuff. I don't suggest people with fighting dogs or aggressive dogs on their own do a pack walk unless you muzzle them. This is the concept. We do the same thing in our socialization. You don't have to like the dog that's next to you, but you have to learn to exist with the dog that's next to you. Okay? Move the body, the mind will follow. Move the body, the mind will follow. So, two dogs, I don't like you, I don't like you. Guess what? We're migrating together. So, the goal for me for the pack walk is for all dogs, no nonsense. Okay? Obviously, no pulling. So, the walk itself is the same. No pulling, no marking, no barking, no lunging. Okay? But in a pack, I want my pack to be behind me, even one step behind me, and I want my pack to be migrating with me. True pack leadership, you know, I believe in the pack structure. I believe in dominance. So I'm going this way. You guys are going with me. So that's the short version of the pack walk. All right, let me see here. Let me get to some of these. Kathleen, it's a direct flight in the Middle East from Qatar to Abu Dhabi. What about customs? Should I give them a tranquilizer? Do not tranquilize your dog when you're going to fly your dog. Absolutely not. Do not do that. As far as customs now, I don't know if there's a quarantine or not. I don't think Abu Dhabi has a quarantine. They won't, because it's not coming from the U.S. You should be okay. If you've got a quarantine, it's a whole different story. You still wouldn't knock out your dog. So customs can be pretty quick. Have all the documentation. I would use a professional service. That's what I would do. Okay? Okay. Diana, I see you guys constantly working on confidence levels for dogs on your Facebook page. What activities does that include exactly? I mean, place, kennel up, etc., commands. I'd love to work on confidence levels for a dog. Okay. Fully train your dog on leash and off leash. Diana. Okay. I never had allergies before. What is this? Let me just do some coffee here. As far as things like the agility equipment, the agility equipment is a really confidence-building thing. Going over a small jump is confidence. Going up onto a small box is confidence. Going through a tunnel is confidence. Going on the teeter-totter, that's a lot of confidence. Up the A-frame is confidence. Start out small. Use food if you want to. I've got no problems with that at all. When I first started getting into this, I was pretty hardcore. I didn't use food at all. I use food now, but I use it very selectively. You have to remember, how do I use it? Puppies, I use it all the time. So I never really worked with any puppies because that's not my business model. Now I'm getting tons of puppies in, and I'm actually going to be doing I've got another puppy coming in tomorrow. I'll probably film the whole one-hour consult. But for confidence stuff, the more structure you can put in that dog's life, the better. Unfortunately, right now, your dog probably just can't make its own decisions or makes wrong decisions. So you got to hold its hand right now. But eventually you want to get out of kindergarten. But I assure you, when your dog now struggles going over a jump or through a tunnel, as soon as it can, it'll be really great. Barb, you lost sound. My sound levels right now, I'm looking at my sound levels right here. On my end, I got sound. So maybe you hit something. Laura, when do you use treats for training? I use treats for training on all my puppies. We use treats for agility. If I did task training, service dog task training, I would use treats for that. If a dog is struggling, say, on a basic command like a down, we use pressure on the down. Terry, you're welcome. We use pressure on the down. If the dog knows down, but it's resisting the pressure the way we do it, I'll take a food morsel. I'll still do pressure. I'll give it to the dog. Get the dog in the right position. Take away the food. So when I use food, I usually take it away within one or two times. I just want to know the dog is doing it. So the clients that we get in, we don't use that much food. But I've been open to do. We've been doing more. We're experimenting with some food with some of our aggression rehab stuff. We're doing more. We've got some severely human aggressive dogs. What we're doing is we're actually only feeding it through training. So you don't get any food during your meals. The only time you get food is when you work. So you came in there to our boarding train wanting to attack us. Guess what? The only way you eat is you've got to do what I ask you to do. And actually, it's more of a proactive type of training than a reactive type of training. So you think when we've got a highly aggressive dog, you think we're going to be strong-arming it. If it goes to bite us, absolutely. But on all the basic stuff, not at all. Not at all. Okay, let me just scroll through some of these, delete out some of the ones that I should. What's going on here? Sam, you're welcome. Monica, I have a little wiener dog, a dachshund, I would imagine, in foster, who's a fear biter. She gets very uncomfortable when people approach her, especially when she's confined in a crate. I'm now able to put my hand in to remove her with a leash, but no one else. How do I get her to trust other people without having many people? Am I disposed or willing to work with the issue of her? Okay, Monica, first of all, I'm not surprised your dog's biting people when it's in the crate. You've got to advocate for your dog, Monica. First of all, I love the fact that you're fostering this dog. Thank you so much. If it wasn't for you, this dog would probably be dead. It's a biting dog. Biting dogs don't survive. So let's do this. Let's get this dog to start thinking that no one is ever going to bother it. Okay? That no one's ever going to bother it. So what I'm going to suggest you do is this. Collar on the dog, leash on the dog, keep the leash out of the crate. Okay? I want you to start training the dog to recall out of the crate. Take the leash, whatever the dog's name is, wiener dog, here. Pull the leash. Good. Back in the crate. I want you to teach that dog how to crate up and how to come out of the crate. Crate up, how to come out of the crate. That should be your number one exercise you're doing right now. Kennel up. Let's go. Kennel up. Let's go. Or kennel up here. Over and over and over and over and over again. If the dog is so deathly afraid it won't come out, try what you could do is try, don't feed it until it comes out. So in other words, you're not starving the dog. But don't feed the dog. You want to eat, guess what? This is the game we're going to play. Kennel up. Good. Here, you come out, kibble. kennel up. Here, you come out, kibble. It eats its meal by coming out. That's a good way to do that. Let's try that. Okay. Kathleen, no quarantine, just medical exam. If you've got a biting dog, this is the one that's going to Abu Dhabi. If you have a biting dog, you've got to muzzle it. And if you told customs, listen, my dog just flew. It's highly stressed. I'd like to muzzle it, please. It's not an aggressive dog, but if the vet is experienced, they should know. What I would do is I would have your vet in your home country now, contact the vet at customs, find out what the protocols are. It'll probably run smoother than you think. I've dealt with a lot of consulate people. They fly dogs all over the place, and you should be okay. Let's see. Okay, I answered that one. Thank you guys so much. Laura, did I answer you? When do I use treats for training? I answered that one already. Amy, sometimes in place my dog starts whining or barking. I think she wants to get up, but I don't allow it. How can I stop it? Okay. So we use remote collars for no and go. Okay? Remote collars, the way we train is we're going to teach you to do some awesome stuff, but I also want to be able to tell you to knock something off. So low-level remote collar stim. Whine, stim. Not shock, not zap. I don't want you to be jumping up. I just want you to be, you whine, pop. You whine, pop. The dog goes, what the heck was that? Whine, pop. What the heck was that? The dog should stop. I want you to try that. But you've got to interrupt and or correct whining. Bottom line. That's what you do. You don't teach the quiet command. Quiet, treat. Quiet, treat. Dog's too smart for that. Dog's too smart for that. All right. Get that. Confidence building. Tara, he can try switching the pack order on the sled. Try that. That might have been out of my my league on that one as far as that. So direct flight, I got that one. Okay. Beth, I'm wondering about your opinions of using Prozac for dogs. I have a rescue collie and posted earlier. I did get a prescription for it with a collie, but have not started it yet because I'm wary. Do you think it's useful, especially if I used along with training? I've been doing some training with him, but mostly a lot of engagement play. It's great. Don't worry about your engagement stuff. It's great training. Marker training. Marker training is great. About 4 or 5 years old. Okay. I am not against drugs. Absolutely not against drugs. What I'm against, though, is someone giving a dog drugs, a professional, without actually working the dog. So we like dogs to be off of drugs when they come on the property. We like to work them for 2 weeks minimum. Then I am not an expert on drugs at all. I'm not qualified to talk about drugs. I can't prescribe drugs. You don't take any drug advice. Don't take any drug advice from me. If it was my dog and I worked it and then I started seeing, you know what? That's not a training thing anymore. That's an up here thing. So we just had a dog go home that definitely needed to be on drugs. This year, we do about 200 dogs a year on our board and train. I think four, I've said, that's a drug dog. So think about that. Four. Now, I wouldn't be surprised if all 200 went to a vet behaviorist. I would probably say 75% of those dogs would be prescribed drugs. But drugs don't fix anything by themselves. You definitely want to do some training as well. You definitely want to do some training as well. All right. Thanks, Beth. That was a good question. Okay, I'm trying to fix my scroll here. Let me go up here. Let me see how these are coming in. I'm missing a lot of questions here. I know, tons of questions, guys. If I don't get all to your questions, what I'll do is we'll use them on this Saturday show. Speaking of this Saturday show, it's a new podcast now. Tonight, I'm going to actually launch the link. It's just like the link you got for this, but it'll be the link for this weekend's radio show on Saturday. You'll be able to actually see in the booth live. You can see Linda and myself. Okay, Tammy. I'm going to be doing lure coursing and agility. I've been using the prong collar for training and will be using remote collar for recalls on this pup, but won't be able to for these activities. Agreed. What's the best way to proof the recall when the e-collar comes off. Thanks so much for doing this. You're amazing at sharing your knowledge. Thanks for participating. Okay. If you get that dog, first of all, your remote collar should be on. Wake up, collar on, go to bed, collar off. Switch it from this side to this side of the neck every 4 hours just so you don't get any, the dog, they don't burn, but it's a pressure sore. Remote collars can't burn dogs. They just don't. Take a remote collar, put it in gasoline, hit the button, and you have no explosion. You've got no flames. There's no spark. So there's no such thing as burning. But anyway, we talk about low-level remote collar training all the time. But we also talk about, at some point, you have to hold the dog accountable. You'll only be on correction mode, So what I suggest you do is get that dog on correction mode, meaning you're not prompting anymore. So it's not, you know, max here, prompt, max here, prompt, max here, prompt. That's how we train. That's kindergarten. Now, you want to get out of kindergarten, it's max here, comes every time. Max here, comes every time. Dog doesn't come, you're in a correction mode, which is higher than your low-level training mode for non-compliance. And you've been fair. Let's keep that in mind. So we never use a remote on a dog until we've trained the dog what we want. Sorry about that. Until we train the dog what we want to do. So think about that. I've done recalls 150 times. I've done downs 150 times. Now I ask you to call back, to come back now. You don't come back? Come on. How long have we been working on this? So I got to let you know I don't agree with that. So higher level. What's the level? I don't know. The dog will tell you. You do something called dialing up. Dialing up is, I guess I should have a remote collar here with me. I will next time. Dialing up is you hold the continuous button down, you slowly dial up, the dog feels pressure, 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 pressure. Okay, here I come. Then you look at your number. 45. Who knew? You've got to go. Now, once you know the dog's at 45, what you can do now is switch to momentary. If you're not familiar with this language, folks, don't worry about it. I've got videos on this. And I can do a whole webinar just on the remote collar one day. Name of dog, so max here. Dog doesn't come, go right to correction. Right to correction. Pop, you're not zapping, you're not shocking, you're letting that dog know, I don't agree with that. It's life or death. Now, with agility, it's not life or death, but still, in my world, dog's outside, there's streets, it's unfenced, it's life or death. So what I need you to do is, I need you to come back every time. When a dog is on correction mode only, they come back. So, they come back. Now, agility, lure coursing, way higher distraction. So what you might want to do is you might want to proof it in private, or I would ask the instructor if you can start doing private training on the course with the remote so you can pattern the dog. I don't know. Is it competing? Is it fun? You know, I'd like to think that people would, you know, want to help you out, so try that. Okay? Tara, Sophia, 15-month-old German Shepherd dog, doesn't like thunder and can't figure out how to get her to ignore or at least tolerate it. Was able to get her off the vacuum cleaner. Any suggestions? Okay. Guys, thunder and fireworks suck. I don't know if you can hear them in the background here. I live in a very urban area. In Rhode Island, fireworks are legal now. They're not supposed to be the ones that make noise or fly through the air, but people have them. All sides of my house, it's horrific. Every dog on my property is locked down, and some of them struggle. So, what do? You want to counter-condition your dog. So a lot of times with counter-conditioning, you want to make a new association. You do that with food. New association, so you get thunder, get a soundtrack of thunder. On YouTube, you can get 10 hours of thunder. 10 hours of thunder, feed the dog. So anytime you want to counter-condition, what you're doing is you're making a new association with that noise or stimulus. I'm not an expert on counter-conditioning, but I would try that. You don't correct the dog. You can't correct your dog for being freaked out. Now, what you can do is you can command your dog to go to place and keep your dog there, but I would start doing both if you want to do that or also counter-condition. Okay, so try that. I know these are really short answers. I'm trying to get to everybody. There's over 100 questions here, guys. So sorry. Actually, it's great. I love your passion. I love all the involvement here. I'm so excited to help all you out. This is just, I'm giddy. I'm happy. This is great. I just need my coffee. No, I'm not going to stop drinking coffee. Okay. Kay, when I remove the prong collar, my dog gets excited and starts to jump on us. How do I get her to stay calm when the collar's removed? Two prong collars, okay? So, one prong collar on, one prong collar on a leash. Dog jumps up, pop. There you go. Practice, role play. Collar on, collar off. Collar on, collar off. Excitement, pop. Trust me. Pop with a leash, not hitting the dog. Pop. I know your dog's excited to have the prong collar on. I love it. Or have the prong collar off. That's great. But don't let your dog practice an unwanted behavior, which is jumping. Okay. Let's see. Okay, I got that one. Pierre, I see your question, but let me get some of these first-timers here. Laura, how do you feel there's a correlation between diet and behavior? Well, kids eat McDonald's, how do they do in school? Kids drink Tang, eat junk food, how do they do in school? Right? Same thing. Most dog food is, and most treats are just, you know, crap. Beth, I'm going to get back to you. Yes, let's see. Okay. Amy, how are you able to actually snap the muzzle on a dog such as Murphy? I saw the whole process of getting him to use to putting the muzzle on. It wasn't easy. It was hard. Tina was actually the one that was able to get it on. Murphy's got a really, really terrible thing with men. Doesn't like men at all. So the dog doesn't like men at all. I've seen it before to small extremes. This was a dramatic. We can take a female, any female from our building, grab Murphy's leash, the dog warmed right up to him. Myself and John, who were training him, was rough. It was really, really rough. But what you can do is you can have the muzzle already hooked together. JAFCO muzzles are a little bit elastic, and then what you can do is you can put the dog, get the muzzle on, and then you can just make a quick movement like that. Laura, you're welcome. Irene, you say you don't get bit anymore. I used to get bit all the time. Why? I had a huge ego. My ego was huge. I was working with dogs that were way above my ability, and I was doing stupid stuff. I was rushing the training. That's how I used to get bit. I wasn't reading dogs properly at all. That's exactly how I get bit. Now I'm like, okay, no problem. We'll get back to that. I got no problem. I got nothing to prove. I've worked with some of the nastiest dogs out there. I got nothing to prove at all. I'm going to take my time with you. So that's how I don't get bit anymore. Now the only time I probably would get bit is breaking up a dog fight. It's probably the only time I would get bit right now. Diana, okay, Diana. Hey Jeff, I'm still struggling with our 10-month-old pit bull, meeting and seeing other dogs in public. I've watched your videos and it seems like having a stable dog girl, in your case, is key when trying to practice. But in our case, we don't have a stable dog in our house. Most people don't. Don't worry about that. To help with this issue, what do you recommend to try to get him on the point where we can bring him in public and not worry that he will snap? Muzzle, definitely, but anything else? Okay. Muzzle. And, well, first of all, hold on here. Going back to this. Meeting, okay, your dog should not be meeting other dogs in public, Diana. Let's just get that right out of the way. I don't let my dogs meet any dogs in public at all. I don't believe that anybody should be allowing their dog, my opinion, anybody should be allowing their dogs to meet in public, like on a walk. Your dog's on a leash, it shouldn't be meeting any other dogs in public. Now, if your dog's off-leash and you're at the beach and there's other off-leash dogs, yeah, I guess it's going to. If you're at a dog park, which I don't like dog parks at all, it's going to meet other dogs. But as far as you're walking your dog down the street, whether it's an on-leash dog or an off-leash dog coming towards you, you don't meet the dog, ever. So let's forget about that. Now, seeing other dogs, so technically then you don't have to have a muzzle on your dog. Unless you've got a lot of off-leash dogs that are rushing up to you And if you've got a lot of off-leash dogs running up to you, you should be carrying a pet convincer, which is... it's missing the nozzle to it. This is a pet convincer. There's a silver, little silver thing on there. Hold on, you know what I might have? Somebody, shoot. Let me try something here. Display offer. What is it? What just happened? Offer displayed? Something was supposed to happen with an offer displayed. Anyway. Let me try something else. I got some polls here, guys. There's a question that I asked. I don't know. We're experimenting this. Start the poll. Okay, good. So there's a poll. Take some poll questions. Take some poll questions. Okay. So as far as seeing other dogs in public, if your dog is being really, really reactionary to them, we've got a lot of protocols to do for that. I'm probably going to do a webinar video on how to handle dogs that are reactive in public. So what I'm going to do is probably set up the camera at my training facility, and I'm probably going to do a you're going to watch me work with a dog. So I'm just experimenting with this webinar stuff, but wouldn't that be cool that if I set up a camera and I know it would get a certain area of the training floor, and then what I can do is I can work a dog and everybody can see it. I guess I would have to just see how the like right now when I'm moving my hands, I'm seeing like blurriness. So I don't know if you guys are seeing that too. But as far as seeing other dogs in public, keeping your dog in a calm state is always good. Being able to do a 180, a spin around, pet convincer to interrupt the dog, remote collar to interrupt the dog, head the other way for a little bit, not for total avoidance, but for a little bit. But at the beginning, you're going to want to do avoidance training. So avoidance training is you can't look at that dog right now. But that's not the answer. I want you to be the dog to eventually be able to look at it, but right now we have to not do it. Now, if the dog redirects on you, you've got to put the muzzle on the dog. But also, putting muzzles on dogs, that sometimes calms dogs down. So you can try that too. Try that too. Right, Diana? What are we doing on time? Trina, looking forward to seeing you in just a few days. Maybe you could help me then with Mika. She's still mouthing, which is not okay. I've been successful. Trina, I'm going to your house. Well, you're also putting us up and making us fantastic food. So, of course I'll help you. We'll use your dog, Trina. We'll use your dog as a demo dog. I love to help you. I'm so excited. Barb, you got the sound back. Great. Kathleen, thanks. You're welcome. Tara. Oh, Tara, I think you've been there for a little bit. Joey is an American, a bulldog, age 4 years old, taking the training classes three times a week. Three times a week? Holy moly. Highly socialized with other dogs, awesome. Attacked the dog at class because it was flailing around and crying at the end of the leash. Yes, I know. That's rough. Okay, so your dog, 4 years old, well socialized, sees and hears another dog going nuts at the end of a leash. Yep, that's what's going to happen. That's what's going to happen. So what do you do? If you can set that up a lot of times, you got to desensitize your dog to that. So what do you do? Keep your dog on a heel, put your dog in place, put your dog into a down, dog flails around, reinforce it. Or start out with see if you can download that from YouTube, that sound, get a soundtrack of a dog in distress. Try that out. But that can happen a lot. That's a scary situation. Let's see here. Let's see. Amy, I got to. Sorry, guys. I'm just going through all this stuff here. It's a lot of questions. Cassie or Casey, sorry if I destroyed your name there. I tell my dog place command to mean go to one mat in particular. How would I go about generalizing that to another spot I choose? All right, so place command always has to be on a dog bed, a blanket, a bath towel, one of the raised beds that we get from petcot.com. Petcot.com. Buy stuff from them. Mention that you heard it from us, one of our advertisers. Petcot.com. Introduce the new spot. Dog on a leash. Walk up to it. Place. You can take anything you want. So all the same training that you just did, you can do with place. Just introduce it to a new thing. That's all. Just introduce it to a new thing. I love the fact that you were able to do that. Let's see. What's the best, Kathleen? What's the best way to socialize rescue dogs? Large but not aggressive. We got a formula for that. We do a ton of socialization in our place. Large or small, it doesn't really matter. You definitely don't want to put large and small together if you're not, you know, really good at socializing dogs. The biggest thing is advocate for the dog. Advocate for the dog. So when we bring a new dog into a play yard, okay, at the beginning we might do it on a leash. What we do is this. I keep all the dogs, or whatever handler is there, I keep all the dogs away. All the dogs away from the dog that I'm socializing. It's my job. I want that dog to know, holy moly, Jeff's got my back. Look at that. That's wonderful. I don't gotta bark or aggress or growl or anything. We'll talk about growling. Dogs are actually allowed to growl during socialization. So what I want the dog to think is they've got somebody in their corner. Me. Now, socialization is not a playground. In my opinion, socialization is a cocktail party. I want calm. Dogs that are calm, walking around, are not getting into fights. They're not misinterpreting body language. So that's what you want to do with that. It's a longer process. Where did that one go? Hannah, not to sound haughty, but I know I have good timing. I use your techniques on the shelter dogs, and it works like magic. It's just my dog. Isn't that weird, Hannah? You know, you have such good success with all these other dogs, and with your dog, you're struggling. I know. It's frustrating. She pulls like a train, which I have to correct her for, but that overstimulates her or something. Okay, so this is the thing. I want you to – we're going to do a video on this. We're going to do remote collar healing. Bottom line, remote collar healing, okay? So remote collar healing, this is the theory with remote collar healing. And it's not just a theory. I mean, it works. Okay. What you're doing now is dog pulls, you're popping the dog. It's agitating. We see that maybe 5% of the dogs that we work with. Remote collar on the dog. Get the working level. 0 to 100, say it's a 6. Use your prong collar. Have your remote collar too. Dog gets a little bit ahead of you. Don't pop. Pull. So gently pull and stim continues at the same time. So dog gets ahead of you. Pressure and pressure with a leash. Dog all of a sudden backs up. Release the pressure on the remote. Release the pressure on this. Good. Do that a bunch of times. All of a sudden, stop using your hand. Just use the remote. Dog gets ahead of you. Pressure. Not shock, not zap. That's not what we do with collars. Pressure. Dog backs up. Release pressure. Now, still have the prong and the leash on because that's for directional control if the dog decides to lunge. Now, if your dog is still pulling, do some directional changes too. But I want you to remote collar train your dog on the leash, on heel. Okay? Dennis, how do you stop a dog from chasing and biting its tail? That's probably an OCD thing. Don't let him do it. I mean, that could be a very long counter-conditioning thing. What I would do is this. Put the dog in down. Put the dog in place. Now, can it still eat its tail? Yes, it can. Historically, though, the dog gets all worked up. Okay? The dog gets all worked up. So what I want you to do is get the dog into a calm, relaxed state. Now is it still doing it? Okay? Nina, I have a question, Jeff. Thank you so much for all you do and share. Oh, you're welcome. It's so kind of you to say that. I work at an animal shelter in Canada. Hey, I was just up there. Awesome. What happened? We aren't allowed to use any kind of aversive. They only advocate the pure positive method. Is there anything you recommend that I could do and help the dogs become better behaved? Okay. First of all, they do use aversives. I'm not going to get into a science discussion at all, but this is obviously a sticking point for me, okay? Do they put dogs in kennels? Yes or no? Yes, they do. That's an aversive. It's called containment, right? Do they use a flat buckle collar? Yes, they do. Or a slip lead? Yes, they do. All right? So what's happening is an aversive is being used. Bottom line. Okay? So they do use an aversive. Personally, unless I can do what I do, I don't work in shelters. Bottom line. I don't do it. If you don't want me to help your dogs the way I want to help your dogs, I'm the wrong guy for you. Cold, uncaring, dogs are going to be killed. I know. But there's a good video I made about Brick. Brick is a dog in an animal shelter that within 5 minutes, I took his energy from out of control to calm. So watch that video on Brick. It's on my YouTube channel. And all I used was a slip lead at the beginning. I switched over to a prong collar because that's what I do. Now, I could train a dog with a slip lead. Big deal. I'm a dog trainer. But in my opinion, every shelter dog should be trained on a prong. Okay? So let's get rid of this ideology. And I don't, like, if you want to, I'm not going to even, the great thing about this is I can control the questions here. So I didn't even need to say that. So sorry about that. I'm going on a tangent. Yeah, obviously, it's a sticking point with me with dogs in animal shelters. Right? The dogs are dying. Dogs are being killed. Get them adopted. Big deal. You put a prong collar on them. You teach them how to walk, sit, down, place. Don't jump. So if your ideology is so intense that you'd rather have a dog die than put a prong collar on it, geez, that's shameful. How dare you? How dare you allow a dog to be killed that can easily be rehabilitated? But watch the Brick video. What you want to do is watch the Brick video, okay? I know. It sucks. It sucks. Twisting the tail, we did that. I'm getting there, guys. Oh, no, I'm not. I'm not getting there. Trina Carr, can't wait to see you too. Dennis, you're welcome. God, thank you, guys. You guys are thanking me too. Virginia, growling and socialization. Small dog growls when new dogs approach politely and sniff. Happen to be small dog growls instead of walking away. So, okay? All right. Okay. Growling. What's the other dog do? Okay? Now, small dog, big dog. Small dog's hanging out. Big dog comes in. Sniffs its butt. This little dog goes, "Arr!" The dog backs away. All right. Let's see how that goes. The dog comes in, sniffs the little dog's butt, genital area. "Arr!" This. Okay. At some point, you want to tell this dog to knock it off. But you don't want them to lose that growl for this instance. Now, if this dog walks up to another dog and growls, correct the little dog. Right? You cannot walk up to another dog and growl. That's rude. That's impolite. You can't do that. That's not fair. So, what do? I would see how it would play out. At some point, I would correct the little dog, though. I know. I just, what's that called? Switch my statement. I got to be there. I got to see what the intent of the growl is. I want to watch to see what the other dog does. So. Nina, it's so frustrating because I think the pure positive thing is just trying to be politically correct. Pure positive is just marketing. There's no such thing as pure positive, guys. It's impossible. It's impossible. It is impossible. Next time somebody says that they want to do pure positive, this is what I want you to tell them to do. Take your car, put your dog in your hatchback, leave the door open, drive down the highway. Seriously. They'll look at you like you're crazy. You can't close the door. That's containment. That's an aversive. Really? Really? Come on. Take your dog outside for a walk. No leash, no collar. Nothing. No gentle leader. No martingale. Nothing. So if they say pure positive, no aversives, then but they're using any collar or any leash, they're using an aversive. Challenge them on that. Okay? Challenge them on that. Hannah, oh wait, what's a good and inexpensive e-collar? You can't have both, Hannah. Come on. You can't have good and inexpensive. Get an e-collar technologies. Get a Educator 300. Get an Educator 300. They're $189, all right? $189. Virginia, if the big dog doesn't back off from the growl, you got to move the big dog away. That's your job. Advocate for all the dogs. Advocate for all the dogs, all right? Okay, I'm going through these. I know, Nina, it's frustrating. I know. I hear you. That's why I don't do shelters. That's why dogs are dying. Dogs are dying. People go into this is a blanket statement. It's not every shelter. Historically, from my experience, a lot of people go into animal shelters with just warm hearts. They actually don't want to help the dogs. I know. Politically incorrect statement. It's like I opened up a can of worms. I'm sorry. I don't have good experiences with shelters. So I can only tell you what I know. Virginia, Diana. Diana, how long until we should graduate to remote collar training from prom? It's up to you. We start dogs on remote sometimes. Remember, guys, remote collar training, in my opinion, is actually the quickest, easiest, safest, most humane, most advocating training there is. You know? So, to me, let's see, Diana, Hannah, thanks. Oh, you're welcome. Tara, oh my gosh, thank you. Never thought of a soundtrack. I know, I never thought of soundtracks at 1.2. Now I learned. I know, it's great. Kate, why is it okay for dogs to growl for socialization? That's a really good thing. Dogs are off leash. A dog is uncomfortable. Another dog walks up to it. It growls. It's saying, I'm uncomfortable. The other dog needs to back away. It's okay. It's okay to growl. Now, another dog can't walk up to another dog and growl. Okay? That's not allowed. That's not allowed. Okay? Okay? So, Nina, we use easy walk, no pull harness, which is always promoted over prongs. I know it's promoted over prongs. I know it is. If it works for you, keep doing it. The bottom line is this. If something works, do it. Don't listen to me. Absolutely don't listen to me. If you're doing something now that works, do not do it. The thing is about the harness is I don't like the way that a dog could, and I can't correct the dog. Pressure on, pressure off, it's a little bit different. But if it's working for you, Nina, absolutely keep doing it. Don't stop. Love it. I love the fact that you actually found something that works. Michelle, are there certain dogs that you wouldn't use a prong collar on? No. Prong collar is good for every dog. Laura, I fortunately work with a shelter that allows me to use a prong collar. They are okay with balance training. Love it, Laura. Good job. Michelle, are there certain breeds? Oh, I did that. Certain breeds, okay. It's going over time, guys. Thank you so much for sticking around. Virginia, thanks. You're welcome. Nina, to me, the state of mind that dogs usually are in is suffering. So many anxious dogs that don't have an off switch. Agree 100%. So many dogs struggle out there. This is the thing. If I can get a dog to go from an agitated state to a calm state, whether it's use any tool, anything, I'm going to do it. Why should we allow a dog to stay in an agitated state because we don't believe in a certain tool? It goes both ways. Me too. So if thunder shirts work, use a thunder shirt. I personally have never seen them work, but if they work for you, do it. But if I know there's another tool out there that works, I'm using it. Bottom line, I'm using it. All right. So, Kate, about growing socialization, I answered that. Some of these other questions I'm going to have to do on my radio show this week. Diana, good question, Cassie. Look at that, literal interaction between each other. Virginia, love the information, but seriously, would love to pay for the privilege and have an in-depth convo with a small group, regular access. You guys are the greatest. Virginia, I mean, you guys are awesome. You guys are awesome. This is fantastic. Diana, thank you so much. You're amazing. You're amazing. I mean, you are, and I'm sincere about that. Wish we were closer to Providence. Come on down. We got incredible restaurants. Providence, Rhode Island, incredible restaurants, nightlife, music, hotels, the theater. It's fantastic. It's fantastic. Irene, not a pro trainer, working with some friends' dogs and trying to learn as much as I can. I'm in training to be a trainer. That's great. Michelle, are there why does it seem like the questions are being duplicated? Amy. I'm going to have to, what time? It's 9:05, guys. There's a lot of questions left. Listen, I'm going to take every one of these questions, all right? Every one of these questions. I'm going to start my Saturday show with these questions, all right? I promise you, you'll also be able to see me. We're experimenting with webinars. We're experimenting with cameras. All my life I was told I've got a face for radio, but I'm getting in front of the camera for you guys. I want you to know this has been special for me. This has been so special for me. There's about 25 more questions here. Thank you so much for attending this webinar. It's only an hour long, 8 to 9. Obviously, that's not long enough, but that's about all I can last right now tonight. Plus, that's how long it is. I've got some Skype sessions already booked. I do private Skype sessions. Thank you so much. I'm Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. This really, really has moved me. All right? Thank you, guys. I'll talk to you soon. Save all these questions because I'm afraid if I shut this off, I know I'm still on the air, guys. I'm afraid if I stop the broadcast without saving the questions, I won't be able to see them. New document. You guys were fantastic. Boom. All right, all the questions have been saved. I'm going to stop the broadcast now. I'll see you guys. Now, for real, I'm going, all right? I love you guys so much. I really do.